evening, and welcome to Winterstown United Methodist Church. We have a few announcements, and before we get started, Ann Dougherty has an announcement she would like to make.
Good morning, everyone. The mission team is going to sponsor a fundraiser for the month of October to support our trip in July of next year. In your bulletin, you will find a pretty orange piece of paper. It is a fundraiser calendar. Each day of October has something marked, and each of these things has something to do with your home. A lot of these things are things we take for granted, or things that I would consider a luxury. And when we go to work for these people, a lot of them will not have these things. So if we can give out of our thankfulness. There are collection containers on the table right outside the sanctuary if you want to pick one up on your way out. If you're able and willing to help, you fill your cup, and then we can just bring them in November. And we appreciate all your support. Thank you very much.
Senior Youth is preparing a challenge to our church family to fill the table in the narthex each week for four Sundays in October with specified items needed by the Red Line Community Services. On the first Sunday, which would be October the 9th, they would like canned vegetables, especially canned jams, canned fruit, canned meats and fish, canned stews, and sloppy joe sauces. Pastor Mitch will be on vacation from September the 12th through the 25th. If you are in need of pastoral care during this time, please call Reverend Tim Funk. Rediscovering Our Youth and the Winterstown Elementary School PTO is organizing a fall festival. The event will be held at the Winterstown United Methodist Church on October the 22nd from 12 to 3. They are in need of volunteers to help at the event, so if you can help, please sign up on the bulletin board and duties will be assigned on the date of the event. If you have any questions, you can contact Troy Hildebrand. This week's activities are Sunday, the 18th, the senior youth are meeting at 2, and on Thursday, the 22nd, the Child Care Board will meet at 6:30. Birthdays for this week. On Sunday, Darren Hess and Corey Grove. Monday, Earl Krieger, Adam Kobe, Carol Galloway. On Tuesday, Jeremy Latimer, Paul Jones. On Thursday, Kelly Krynick. On Friday, Diana Bertling, and on Saturday, Ruth Ann Groff, and we wish all of them a happy birthday. And anniversaries this week on Thursday are Jeff and Jamie Enfield. At this time, we will have a time of fellowship.
Thank you.
think I'm about done. I tell you, if I can stand way back here, I can see that. But I don't know how close I got to wear these glasses. I bet people think, what is wrong with that? Good morning. We will now have the call to worship.
Maybe.
Please remain standing. I love you, Lord, my strength.
You, Lord, are my rock, my fortress, my deliverer.
My God, you are my rock in whom I take refuge. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise.
He saved me from my enemies and lifted me up to his holy mountain.
Therefore, I will praise you, Lord, among all people. I will sing the praises of your name. And now please remain standing for the first hymn, My Jesus, I Love Thee, found on page 172 or on the screen.
Thank you. This brings us to our time of our prayers and joys. So Troy has a microphone, so anybody that has a joy or a concern, just raise your hand and Troy will come and give you the microphone. Any joys or concerns this morning? Sandy.
I just want to tell you I have the joy that Sylvia and Larry are here with us to worship this morning.
Okay, welcome this morning. Glad to have you here. Anybody else, a joy or concern?
I'd like to have prayer for my cousin who was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she has gone through surgery and is now in the future going to get chemotherapy.
Thank you. Anybody else, a joy or concern?
We'd like to ask prayer for Jane Workinger, a friend of ours that just had some surgery. And I'd like to ask for traveling mercies for Earl and Dorothy Haley, who just are ending a successful week this week at the York Fair and then leaving tomorrow morning to go to Beavertown for another week of fair.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else? Joy or concern? Okay, let us join our hearts together and as we seek the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you that as we gather in your name, you're here in our midst. We thank you for the blessing of knowing that you hear our prayers and that your hand is moved as we come and seek your presence. Seek your healing hand in certain situations, being able to open up avenues of success where none seems visible, that you guide us with our decision-making processes, Lord. So many different areas that you bless us and touch us. We just give you thanks and praise for that. We thank you that we live in a nation in which there is the freedom to worship you and to share with one another. We thank you for friends that join us. We do ask that your touch would be upon each one of us here this morning with the concerns that we have and with the joys that we have. For each week, we seem to go through different valleys and mountaintops, and we thank you for each one of those, for through them we can rejoice, and through them that we can increase our faith and our trust in you. All those that were mentioned this morning, we ask that your hand would be upon them, that you would heal where that healing is needed with that cancer situation, heal the other situations that were expressed, situations from a bad fall in the first service that was mentioned, and a family that is now homeless. The student is one of the little boys is a student of Jill. We ask that you would touch that family. And Lord, we just thank you and praise you that you're there, that you will answer our prayers. And we bring them all unto you, Lord. As we worship today, we ask that your visitation would be rich and free, and that we would know and understand how you're working in our lives as we work together as your church here at Winterstown. Give us the right light. Give us the right love that we can share, the words to share, and the way that we walk. Let it touch other individuals, Lord. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus, who taught us to pray when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now as we join in our next hymn, Rise as You're Able, and we will sing Pass It On, number 570. Please be seated. At this time, we will share with the Lord our gifts and our offerings that he has blessed us with as we seek to increase the work of the Lord. I'm sorry. Wait a minute. I'm off track. I'm getting the signals. I'm sorry about that. We can't miss this. The anthem is going to share with us, not I, but Christ. I apologize for that. Thank you. Thank you very much. A wonderful word of the Lord, encouragement to us. Okay, now we will honor the Lord with our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. Would the ushers please come forward? Lord, we thank you for your many blessings. We thank you now for the privilege of sharing of those blessings with others. Let this be an honor to you, a mark of your love to us and to others, that they might accomplish much here at Winterstown and even around the world. Bless the gifts and bless the givers. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Okay, we're going to look at a little section of Scripture today that God is sharing with us through Paul as we kind of get to the end of the book of 1 Corinthians. So he's taking this and he's really teaching us a number of things, kind of in summary of what he's been sharing in the first 14 chapters of 1 Corinthians. So we're going to get kind of the summary. He's going to show us exactly what we can expect coming in the future and some guidance along those areas. I'm not going to read the scripture first. We're going to look at it as we go along piecemeal. We're going to jump here and there, kind of as the Lord gave me various thoughts. They weren't chronological, you know. Engineers, you know, they jump around a little bit, trying to put the puzzle together. So hopefully that has meaning to us today. So we'll jump right into the message and look at those particular passages as we go along. So you might want to take out your Bible or a pew Bible because it is going to jump around a little bit so that you can see and understand some of the things that Paul is talking about. It is not part of our everyday language that we hear. So it's something that we want to be able to understand. So let's pray first. Father God, we just thank you and praise you that you are here with us. We worship you through learning and seeking and trying to understand your word, your will for us. Help us to be those that surrender our lives and serve you in a way that you have called us to do that. Help each one of us to find your will for our lives as we go forward, and help parts of your word here to help us on that journey. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. So we're going to look at the message title, which is Made Brand New. Do you like to get things that are brand new? I do. It's better than getting something old and broken. Something brand new is much better. So we're going to look at the brand new that God is sharing with us here through Paul. So the first verse that we want to look at is the one that's kind of dictates, who is Paul talking to? Who is he addressing in this particular situation? And it tells us who he's been addressing, and the information that he's been giving us in the first 14 chapters, and how to get to this point, and then kind of the summation of these verses. But verse 57 says, "But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." The greatest gift on earth that you and I can receive is to become the children of God. There's no greater gift. Now, I'm sure that a lot of us have had great parents. And I praise God for my parents. But being a child of God takes us to a whole new level. You know, our parents will still be our parents forever, but being a child of God is something way better, and it's the greatest thing that we can give. And he says, thanks be to God who gives us. Okay, as his children, he gives us things. He gives us blessings so that we can celebrate with thankfulness, he tells us. We can take pen and pencil and we can write a big list of the things that he's blessed us with through our lives. I know sometimes I focus on the things that weren't so great. But when I take time to look, there's so much better. And this is just a glimpse of a foreshadow of what it's going to be like in his presence forever and ever, made brand new. So he's addressing this to those who have achieved victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So he's addressing this to believers, those that have said to Jesus, yes, I want you to be a part of my life. I want you to be my Lord and my Savior. Come into my life and save me. Wash away my sins. And as we do that, we become his believers, his church, his followers. So that's who he's talking to here. And he says, as we do that, we have victory in him. Here's one other verse that I'd like to share with you, John 6:40. For it says, this is the will of my Father. Everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Wonderful blessing. What a wonderful thing to know that his desire for me is to have eternal life and to have it with him. And it's going to be great and wonderful. We're going to be reunited with a lot of loved ones as we enter eternity. And he's looking for this to happen. But he said, in order for that to happen, especially with looking at verses ahead, there needs to be a victory. We need to personally, every one of us that wants that eternal life with Christ has to choose him. I praise God that there was one day that somebody asked me, would anybody here like to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior? I had no emotion or any pull that I could think of, but I said, yeah, I'd like to do that. And forever that changed my life, the course of direction for my life. So that's something I would guess that probably most everybody here has made that choice. Anyone that hasn't made that choice, you need to do that, because he doesn't promise us any more days than what we have at the moment. So we need to make that choice while we're here on earth, because that choice then becomes an eternal choice. And that's kind of what we're looking at here. God created you and I not to die, but to live eternally with him forever and forever. And it's hard to even fathom what eternity is like, forever and forever with no time, because we're all watching the clock, right? We're all on a time zone. But one thing that we don't hear very much anymore is that there is a glorious heaven. But then on the opposite side, there also is a hell, where those that in this life have said, no, I don't want you, God, and I don't want the Lord Jesus Christ into my life. I don't want that. I'm choosing to go the other way. God does not want that. That's not what he placed us here for. He placed us here to fellowship with him and be with him forever. And God did not create hell for mankind. He created that to bind up Satan and his angels one of these days when he returns. And that was the full thing for it. So we need to share that gospel story with those that we love. Because someday, for each one of us, the door will close on our ability to make a decision to receive Christ if we haven't. And doing that, as we begin to serve God, what that does is that lays up for us treasures in heaven. That's the only way we can lay up treasures in heaven, is by the things that we do here for the Lord in service for him. And we're told in the Old Testament that God has a book, and in that book, before you and I were born, so before Terry Mee was born, God wrote in that book, Terry Mee, and he wrote down there everything that he wanted me to accomplish, his will for my life. And one day believers stand before him when he's handing out rewards, he'll open that book and you say, well, okay, Terry, how closely did you follow my will for your life? And that will have an influence on the rewards that I receive in heaven. And the glorious thing is that there's rewards for everyone, things we don't know, don't understand. So that our whole focus here is to have victory in Jesus Christ. To please God, we're not to be man-pleasers. I know I've lived a lot of my life trying to please everybody around me, but in the end, God says, yes, that's good to be in good communion with those around you. But the ultimate goal is to be a God-pleaser. And I praise God that through Christ, he's given me the victory so that I'm moving in a direction where I can be a God-pleaser more. Than in the past. Okay, so now we're going to jump back to verse 50 and look at that particular verse, and it says, now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. And I'm going to pull 53 in there as well. And 53 says, for this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on the immortality. So my physical body that I have right now, God is telling me, hey, you're not going to be in heaven with that body that's falling apart. You're going to be different when you get to heaven. So all of us, you know, at this point in time, you know, everything that I can see is physical here. We all have that physical body, but God is telling us here that, hey, flesh and blood can inherit his kingdom. There's got to be a change taking place. in my life before I enter that kingdom of eternity with my Lord. There's going to be a change taking place. I like that idea. Not only do I like brand new things, I like a brand new me as well. And that's what God is telling me here. You can't inherit this in your old body. But after I change you to being imperishable, hey, then it's going to be glorious. Then the parts of my body that are not working today will work again. And it will work much better even than when I was young, because God doesn't do anything halfway. He's going to restore us, put on that imperishable, and take away the perishable. And I like what he says in verse 53, where he kind of puts an imperative there. He says, "For this perishable must put on imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality." And that is, I think, a great encouragement to me in the fact that he's saying, you got to do this. So there's no way I can take this body that I don't like right now and take it and be in his presence with it. And that's a wonderful promise. This body will never be subject to disease anymore, to death anymore, to harm anymore. It's going to have unlimited capabilities, and that's glorious. Philippians 3:20 tells us, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there," because that's where Jesus is right now, "and it is going to be the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so they will be like his glorious body." What a wonderful promise that is that our bodies will be like his body. Now we get a little picture of what Jesus' body, when we look at the 40 days that Jesus was here under the earth after his resurrection, as he interfaced with his disciples. And you recall that all of a sudden he showed up in a room. Won't that be something? If you can all of a sudden show up in another room or another place or another location. And the Lord says, "Well, I want you to go do this." And, you know, you're there. We're not hindered by the physical bodies that we have today. So the must for me is a great positive, knowing that I can't take, so that when I move from here, this earth, to heaven, to eternity with him, I'm putting on a new suit. But the suit goes deep, all the way to the very core of me. It's just not an outer garment. But it changes my physical being, and it changes my spiritual being into immortality, imperishable, with my Lord forever and ever. And that's glorious. Because I know I kept hearing and I kept waiting to get to the golden years. I'm at the golden years. And what that means is you're just passing your gold to somebody else. That's what the golden years is. As parts of the body don't work like they used to. And one of the other things that most of us, and I know I have a little trouble with, is getting that perspective of eternity. Most of us are going to live maybe for 80, 90 years before we die. So we're looking, okay, when I'm young, I got to prepare for retirement. And now when I'm in retirement, I got to make it through to the end. So we have kind of an 80 to 90 year perspective on our world. And God says, erase that. That's not true. Have an eternal perspective, because it goes on forever with me. So we need that. And he places kind of in our heart that yearning for eternity in his presence. Okay, we'll look at verse 51. 51 says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed." There's a number of times where Paul, at God's urging, says, I'm going to tell you a mystery. And what that means is there's an unveiling of things that were hidden. Most people didn't understand. But God is saying, okay, at this time in history, I want to unveil this particular mystery so that you will understand that. You know, there's certain things happening today that people, 2,000 years ago could not understand that are happening. So God is revealing through various mysteries, various prophecies, whenever he tells us something that's going to happen in the future, we call that a prophecy. He's sharing that so we'll be prepared for what's going to come in the future. So he's here telling us, I'm telling you a mystery. And what was the mystery in the previous verse? The mystery is we're going to be changed to perfect from imperfect and live eternally with him. So that is kind of the main message here, is that transformation that's going to take place in my life and your life because of Jesus. And the greatest thing that ever took place here on this earth was Jesus Christ coming to earth, giving his life on the cross, the shedding of his blood, and then the resurrection from the dead. That is the greatest event that ever happened. And that's even greater than the creation, because that is what gives life to all of those of us that God has created. So it's a wonderful mystery that now he's sharing with the people, that this is that mystery. And he goes on to say, this is part of the mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. And what he's relating to this, whenever you see the word sleep, he's talking about dead. When I'm dead and I'm in the grave, I'm sleeping. That's the term or the interpretation that we have in the Bible. Whenever you hear sleep, that means I've passed from this life to the next, that I'm dead. And he's saying, hey, I'm telling you a mystery. Not everybody is going to sleep, but we will all be changed. So he's giving us a foreshadow again of saying that, hey, when I return, there's going to be a lot of people that have passed on, that have died, that are in the grave, but spiritually with a temporary body, they're in heaven with me. Because when we die, it's just like an instantaneous window that we go from closing our eyes into the presence of the Lord. Great. No pain to that. As we close our eyes, we're there with the Lord, forever to be with the Lord. So he's saying they're not all going to sleep. We're not all going to die, because some people are going to be living when Christ actually does return to earth. He's going to not only change those that were dead, that were asleep, but those who are alive at the time that are believers, he's changing them in an instant. And we'll talk about that instant just in a minute. So what he's talking about here is the catching away of the church. Jesus talked about it in the 14th chapter of John, where he says, hey, I'm going to prepare a lot of rooms, and once I get those prepared, I'm coming back and I'm bringing you with me. Jesus is saying, hey, there's going to be a time I'm coming and I'm catching away from that world. Before that tribulation takes place, I'm going to remove my church so they don't go through that particular wrath. So that kind of is what he's talking about there. And then in 52, he gives us some timing on that, where he says, in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised, and we will be changed. All to be imperishable. Wonderful thing. The twinkling of an eye, that when he returns, he draws us to himself, it's going to happen that fast, in the twinkling of an eye. People have tried to calculate how fast is the twinkling of an eye. Well, if you blink your eye, they've calculated that that's 11/100ths of a second time frame. But the actual Greek term that was used here is a term we get atomic from. That particular term says this is a period of time. If you divide it again, it's no longer time. It's so small that you can't divide it. So it's in the twinkling of an eye that we are changed. Now, if it's that fast and God catches us up with him, we're told in Thessalonians he catches us up with him in the clouds, you know, we would be traveling much faster than any aircraft on earth could travel. When you take that time frame, instead of, you know, some of our fastest ones are Mach 3 or 4, you know, we're talking Mach 25 or 30 or more. And I wonder, when God catches us up off this earth, is there going to be a sonic boom? You know, it's so fast. You know, aircraft create a sonic boom. Will we, as his children, create a sonic boom when all of a sudden he catches us up to be with him? It's going to be a glorious time, a great glorious happening. And I don't know about that. And then he talks about the last trump. What is the last trump? And for that, you have to go to the Jewish festivals, the Jewish celebrations that God instituted in the Old Testament. There were seven, three in the spring, one in the summer, three in the fall. These were times where he said, I want my people to come back to Jerusalem and worship me in a solemn celebration of worship. And one of the celebrations every year happens on the first month of Tishri. Now, that's the Hebrew calendar. The Hebrew calendar is God's calendar. We use the Gregorian calendar, which is a solar calendar. God's calendar is a combination of solar and lunar calendar. But on the first day of Tishri every year is the Feast of Trumpets, probably more well known as Rosh Hashanah. And to institute that celebration, they used trumpet blasts. There are 100 trumpet blasts to kick off that celebration. They use the shofar, the ram's horn, or a long straight trumpet to do that. And the 100th trumpet blast is much louder, much longer than any of the other ones. And that is known as the last trump. And here, they're using that same terminology here. It's going to happen at the last trump. Now, we don't know the day or the hour that Christ is going to return. Will it be somehow tied with his calling us to a celebration of worship? Who knows? But that's kind of where that term comes. But God is providing a powerful transformation of our lives to be in his presence forever and ever. So what is the end result? Verses 54 to 56 kind of give us that end result where it says, but when this perishable will have put on imperishable and this mortal will put on immortality, then will come the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. So I like the word again where he says when. When means it's going to happen. God never said something was going to happen, and it did not. So when he says when, man, I can count on it. Without a doubt, he's going to do all these things for us, pulling us unto himself because he said that. And at that time, we take part of that glorious promise that he has given us. No more death, no more hurt, no more harm, no more pain, wiping away the tears. It's going to be a wonderful and glorious reunion. Jesus has broken the sting of sin, and everything that he made is brand new. I want to be brand new. I don't know about you. Hopefully you want to be brand new as well. Let us pray. Father God, we just thank you and praise you for promises like this that show us that you're there in our midst, that you care for us, that you love us, that you prepare a way, that as we serve you here, you will watch over us and guide us and strengthen us. But you have so much, something so much more glorious in store for us. Help us look to that, see to that, and understand that, and look forward to that day of reunion with you and with all of our loved ones that have gone on. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, let us stand as you're able and sing our final hymn, Because He Lives. May the love of the Lord spread upon you, May he lift up your feet and guide your path, show you the way, give you wisdom and courage, and a vision that one day we'll be reunited with our loved ones and with him forever and ever. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen.